Anyway, today the job is mainly going to be yours, because I think the best way to look at critical appraisal is to actually critically appraise yourself, because we've been doing Cochrane reviews where we look at articles and we realize that just looking at one checklist and say this is it is not good enough. You really have to go into the article in great detail. I'll give you an example. In a randomized trial, we assess risk of bias. Even in randomized trials and in diagnostic tests, we're assessing simple things, right? What is your result? Is it a good result? Is it likely to be clinically beneficial? Second thing is, can you trust this result? Which means, was the study done well that you know the results are not going to be wrong, right? And then you ask the question, can I apply it? The same thing you apply here also. In looking at a diagnostic test, you say, what were the results? Is it likely to be of clinical benefit in my population? And then you say, the study that it came from, was it done well enough that the results I can trust? And then the third question you ask is, the population, the way they did the study, is it applicable to my setting? That's all you're doing when you do critical appraisal, nothing more than that. You're not looking at style and things of that sort. All that is covered in a different aspect of it. So I just quote a few slides and then we'll go to some of the examples. So you have to think of diagnostic tests, they're used in many, many ways, in predisposition to see who's going to develop a disease, when you're screening, when you're actually diagnosing the disease, when you're also saying what is the stage of the disease it has in staging cancers, or when you decide you want to trigger treatment or increase the treatment because a person is not doing well, I have to give him some other step of the treatment. Or you want to see how progressive, what is going to be the prognosis of this. Or you might say, I want to stratify to say, okay, these people are likely to respond, these people are likely to respond better. In a way, it's like staging and deciding on your treatment. Or you want to say, okay, how effective a drug is. So will the diagnosis improve, the way I diagnose the patient, will it improve the way the prognosis is going to happen, right? And in monitoring, diagnostic tests can be used to monitor the outcomes of disease or to see whether a relapse has occurred. So for all of these things, there's slight differences in the design. So you can't use the same critical appraisal for every one of these. Slight differences are there. So you want to influence outcome. You might say, okay, if I use the test or don't use the test, will it make a difference? Like screening mammography. By doing screening mammography, you can say, okay, I want to pick up cancer. Or you can say, if I do a screening mammography, how many people are going to have better outcomes? That's a different question, and there's a different design for that. So we are looking essentially in terms of diagnostic accuracy so far. We've been saying diagnostic accuracy is what we're looking at. And when you're looking at diagnostic accuracy, you must ask yourself, why are you using it? Because you want to see, can I use the test? And whenever you're using a test, you're going to use it in a particular population to replace a particular test or to add on, saying if I add this on, will I get better outcomes? So those are the kind of ways that you're trying to see, is a test going to be useful? But we also have to think in terms of saying, if I use a test, will it cause harm or is it going to improve outcomes? That's also an important way of looking at test outcomes. But we decided yesterday that we are making our decision on these tests and how good they are because it's going to help us in our treatment pathways on whether we treat or whether we don't treat or do we need additional information to treat. So ultimately, you're asking these questions. All going to boil down to, you've done all your learning. Somebody's going to ask you, are you going to tell me what I have? What are you going to do for me? So when you want to think about that, keep in mind that we don't want to miss disease and we also do not want to unnecessarily alarm people. Although we know some people don't mind me unnecessarily alarmed as long because everybody's got the fear that something terrible will happen to me. But that is not a uniform thing. So when you're looking at a critical appraisal of a diagnostic test, what you're saying is you've got a paper, right? And from that paper, you've got to make a decision which is going to help a patient. So from that point of view, you have to ask yourself, have they reported it properly? So that's the first step. Have they reported all the things in the way they should be done so I can at least make a decision on is the paper good? So reporting standards are different from critical assessment standards. So your reporting standards is your current one is STAR-D, which you probably have seen. And if you want to look at, there's another one called TRIPOD, which is looking at individual prognosis or diagnosis. You have articles talking about prediction guidelines for will a person do better and stuff. To assess that, to see whether they've reported that properly, it's called the TRIPOD statement. And you can get all of this from the Equator Network guidelines. But when we are looking at critical appraisal, we have to use this tool called QADAS2, qualitative assessment, quality assessment of diagnostic accuracy studies. And that is also being used by Cochrane systematic reviews to appraise the quality of individual studies. Of all the studies that they look at, they'll first see, is it, does it fulfill my criteria? And then they will read the study properly and fill in a table of all the characteristics of the study, by which time they have learned enough about the study to make an appraisal of how well is it done. And these are the questions they ask. And these are the questions you will also ask, which is, was a spectrum of patients representative of the patients who received the test in practice? Looking at spectra, looking to see whether they're spectrum bias. And they've class these questions according to what aspects they're looking at. So what do we mean by spectrum bias?
So a test went for the early stages of disease, but your sample is those in the late stages.
Okay. So let me also put it in perspective, saying, what is the reason to go into all of this? Because essentially, when you're doing critical appraisal quality assessment, you're looking for risk of biases. What does risk of bias mean here? Yeah, it's going to alter your results because of systematic ways in which the methods are done. Your results cannot be tested. That's what is meant by bias. And the other thing that you have to worry about is coincidence. So the two things that really affect your results are, one is bias, which can occur because of some confounding going on there. Right? And your beliefs that some works and some doesn't work. And you are not using methods to make sure your beliefs are not influencing the system, or that confounders are not influencing your results. That's the method part of it. The other part of it is to say it could be a chance difference. You've got some, so you also have to look at confidence intervals for all of these estimates, right? So these are the questions we're trying to say, is there spectrum bias in terms of the fact that if I do not include all the people who should be, whom I'm likely to use the test on, I may be increasing the chances of getting higher sensitivity or specificity, and that will affect all my likelihood ratios and stuff. So that is really what you're trying to say, was it a fair comparison for this test? So you have you want to diagnose some condition comparing CT. So you're doing an ultrasound first, to as part of your screening to get people to come in for the thing. You might decide, see, if I don't have a good ultrasound film, I'm not going to send him for CT. And you have to ask yourself, what will be the consequence of that? So the fact is that something that person, some quality of his may contribute to the fact that his ultrasound is not done. Young women who are getting mammography. Right? What are the issues that if you have a lot of overrepresentation of younger women in the sample that you're testing to see how mammography is? One, the chances that young woman is likely to have a disease is very low compared to other people. The other way of looking at it is that women may have dense breasts, and ultrasound and mammography doesn't give you that kind of a picture when you have dense breasts. So these two factors will influence whatever you're taking. The fact that they do have a lower prevalence, but your also pickup rate is also less in people who have it. So it's very difficult to really realize whether the person has got, there is an adequate spectrum. But what you're trying to say is, did they choose a very highly selected group of people, in which in which case the specificity of the test will go up quite a bit. If they use a wide range, then you'll know how differentially it is differentiating between milder and more severe cases.
Sorry, you have a question?
Sorry?
Spectrum of the regulatory population or the spectrum of the clinical presentation?
The spectrum of cases where you are going to apply your test on, has that been the same kind of spectrum that they tested the test on? When they chose people to get the sensitivity and specificity of their test, did they select patients in such a way that, see, my patients are not like this? I have people who we don't even know have the disease, and we're going to use the test in them. Their pre-test probability is low. Right, so did that test, was that test also done in a population where some people, the chances of having the problem was low? So how good is it at picking up the test? How sensitive is it? So if you don't have those kind of people in that thing, that the specificity will be much higher than what you will get. Because sensitivity and specificity are kind of interlinked. You understand? So you have to ask yourself, in the I'm going to use this test in this population. And the paper has used this test in a population. How similar are these?
Maybe it's like grading of input. For example, osteoarthritis may be under clinical grades.
Right.
And if you are doing the test for grade 1, and then you are applying to the whole.
In a way, what I'm trying to basically say is that generally when someone is doing a test, he'll do it on people who've got severe disease, right? But when you use it in clinical practice, you're probably also going to diagnose people who don't have severe disease. So how good is a test at picking up people who don't have severe disease?
We have to specify for this grade.
Yeah. So when you finish your paper, you can say, this paper is good, but it is the limitation is that it did not have this spectrum. So my confidence in using the results of this in a different spectrum, I am not sure if the binder disease it will pick up. And therefore, the sensitivity and specificity they are providing may not be the same when I use the test. My specificity may be much lower than theirs because I've got patients who are not so easily diagnosable. That's the reason why we're saying this. Yeah, sure.
Two different ways of looking at a test.
Yeah.
In terms of a person who is designing the test.
Very loudly.
If there are two ways of looking at a test for when they are planning to design a test. Like for example, from a person who is designing the test, he wants to address a clinical syndrome. Say. A meningitis is there.
Yeah.
So in meningitis, a person is trying to devise a test to identify a particular etiology. So when designing the test, the person who is designing the test would be looking at how to differentiate between the four or five common etiologies and how this test will pick up better than the other four. So in that time, he would want to include representations from each of those etiologies equally so that it could be differentiated better. But sir, when it comes to a person who is applying the study, like a clinician, he would say that in my representative spectrum, say etiology 4 and 5 are less than 1%, whereas the others are more. So there will always be a discrepancy when a person is designing the study to a person who is...
Yeah, so I think the problem here is, as rightly brought out by somebody I heard talking about, he's saying that if you look at the way trial development goes on, drug development and delivery goes on. It goes through phases of stage 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4, and then you have a phase 4 trial done by the industry. And a lot of people doubt whether that's accurate. Then they'll have an independent confirmation of those. Where does that happen in diagnostic test development? So you have to think of yourself, see, you're saying, you are diagnosing, I'm using a set of primers to diagnose a condition in my lab. Right. Is that set of primers independently confirmed by somebody else? And is it on a slightly different spectrum of patients? So one of the critical appraisal items in a menu looking at diagnostics is, was there an independent verification of these standards on another population? That's, if it's not there, you're very suspect whether it'll actually be reproducible in another population at the same cutoff levels. So the other point is, here you are trying to develop a test to say this is highly specific for meningitis. Now if you take only people with meningitis, of course it will be highly specific for meningitis. It's, we don't have anybody else there. So you start like that, and then you say, okay, I'm going to do another thing to see how good is it at discriminating between the different forms of meningitis. You have to do that. And only then can you start putting it in practice. Okay, so very often you have to see in the development of this test where all these stages gone through, that it's got good discriminating ability, which means it's got sensitivity to pick up people with the condition, and very few of these people are actually false positives. So that's what we have to look at. So that's what they're talking about in spectrum bias.
Sir,
yeah.
So suppose we want a test for early detection of meningitis. Is it better to have a sample which has all the grades of meningitis, or is it better to have a sample restricted to only grade 1 of that particular?
You first have to have a test which you know picks up meningitis, your kind of meningitis, as he's pointing out. If you know that this is picking up meningitis, now you're going to see how good is it in discriminating between different kinds of meningitis. So the stage where you're talking about, then you should have people with who normally come to you with a clinical suspicion of meningitis.
Yeah, where the clinician suspects.
The clinician says, I think this is meningitis and I want to apply a test. And I'm told by the manufacturer that this test has got reasonably good sensitivity as well as specificity. Okay, because many times you'll find people are reporting, no, they miss the word accuracy. The word accuracy is what is used to describe your sensitivity and stuff, no? So you'll have a test which has got 90% sensitivity in picking up dangerous conditions. And the newspapers will report that accurate, they're accurately diagnosed. But when you apply that to a population, the prevalence is low, that accuracy is ridiculous. So it depends on where you're using it. So in the test situation, it had high accuracy. But in the clinical situation, where the prevalence may be different, that accuracy will change. So it's always a thing. So anyway, we will look at these papers and then we will discuss and see whether the spectrum bias is there or not. Was there a representative spectrum? The next one is the reference standard likely to classify the targeted condition? So it's talking about the gold standard, right? Now, the problem in medicine is a lot of the time, except maybe from a biopsy where you really have got a lot of experience, we are really not sure how good the gold standard is. And you may come across a study where they're evaluating one test versus the so-called gold standard, but the so-called gold standard is not that good. Yesterday, Mohan was talking about an example of how they are trying to see, because there apparently is a guideline that for women with infertility, when you're doing, to see whether they are ovulated, you must do a blood test. What is the test?
Serum progesterone.
Serum progesterone. Right. Now they are trying to see, because they don't normally do it here, and I asked him to ask all the RMU specialists in the country, how many of you, that's a paper. Because you see, nice guideline says everybody should do this. These guys don't do it because they believe that 90% of the time, and you select people who've got proper periods, regular periods, 90% of the time they've ovulated. So he's trying to prove it. Right? So he's now got a problem that serum progesterone levels, that's supposed to be the gold standard. But now there's also an ultrasound test. Right? So you first have to show which is better, the ultrasound or this. So the ideal way to do that study is to do all three things at one shot.
I'd like to present that at some point.
Why don't we just talk about it now? Because that's what we want to discuss, no? Fantastic. Oh, you'll have to do one thing. Put it on a thumb drive and bring it.
I'll just draw for that.
Yeah, you can draw. That's fine. Perfect. Thank you.